Okay, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let's start. Today our topic is the month of Safar and bad luck. And there are many misconceptions everybody knows and many innovations about the month of Safar. So we learn today about all these in Islamic perspective, inshallah. Inshallah, let's start. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, الذي نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي ربي زدنا علما اللهم فقهنا في الدين اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا Wazidna ilma. Okay, let's listen to the recitation first and then we'll start, inshallah. Okay, these were the ayah from Suratul Isra, and Suratul Isra has another name, Suratul Bani Israel, and this was ayah number 12. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we have made the night and day two signs, and we erased the sign of the night and made the sign of the day visible, that you may seek bounty from your Lord and may know the number of years and the count of time. And everything we have set out in details. So the month of Safar is the second month of the lunar calendar. Everybody knows that, the Islamic calendar. And there are, everybody knows, many misconceptions about this month, about the month of Safar. We'll see all that. We see that there are many misconceptions prevalent among the people regarding this month. On one hand, bad lucks and omens have been associated with this month. And on the other hand, self-made solutions for such things have been proposed as well. Such as, number one, not holding marriages in this month. People would say, oh, this is not good month. We shouldn't hold marriages. Then they boil chickpeas and distribute them to the so that the bad omens are passed on to others. And some people, they make 365 balls of flour from which we make the bread and, you know, roti and chapati and parathas from that flour. And why 365? Because there are 365 days in a year. So they make 365 balls of flour and throw them in water so that bad omens are driven away and provision is increased. Their risk, sustenance, provisions, you know, is increased. And this way they, you know, spoil the environment of the sea, and poor sea animal, you know, they spoil their, I think they held their stomach also, you know, what they have to do with this, you know, flower balls. And some people, they recite Surat al-Muzammil 313 times. They consider this month to be hard for the dead, and they consider the 13th of this month referred to as Tera Tezi or Tera Tezu, to be unlucky. They say the in Safar, the 13th, the 13th date or the 13th day of the month is called unlucky. And Tera means 13. In Urdu, they say Tera. So they have kept this day, the name Tera Tezi. Okay. And they say it's an unlucky day. And they do all these things which I told you and many other things you also know. Okay. Everybody knows what people do, right? So, and you know what happens, that all such superstitions and beliefs have no basis in Islam whatsoever. How, now just imagine, how can any day or month be unlucky or be a portent of bad omen when in fact months and years are formed by the alteration of day and nights and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made day and night as a sign and to help us make the calendar, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, which we have already listened the recitation also, and we have appointed the night and the day as two signs. Then we have obliterated the sign of the night with darkness, while we have made the sign of the day illuminating, that you may seek bounty from your Lord and that you may know the number of the years and the reckoning. And we have explained everything in details with full explanation. This is Surah Bani Israel or Suratul Isra, ayah number 12. Okay. Now we see that Allah has told us the purpose of the different stages of the moon. It helps us to mark the beginning and end of the months. Everybody knows that, right? Because when you see the moon, you know now this is tomorrow, it is Ramzan and I have to fast. When you see the moon, you know now the next month is of the Hajj, okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also told us that there are 12 months. He says, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they ask you about the new moon. Say, these are signs to mark fixed periods of time for mankind and for the Hajj, for the pilgrimage. Okay. And now we see the hadith about the month of Safar and bad luck. The Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, La adwa wala tayarata wala hamata wala safara. La adwa, no disease is infectious. And wala tayarata, nor is there any reality in evil omens. Like, you know, some people, you know, I've got evil omens. Some people, they go somewhere, they leave the house, they go for a job or to meet somebody anywhere, they go to the hospital. When, you know, in the way they find black cat, they say, now something bad is going to happen. You know, such beliefs. So in reality, nor is there any reality in evil omens. Wala hamata, neither in an owl. Now, you know, owl is a bird. Everybody knows that. Now, they had a belief that they believe that if this owl is, you know, its voice comes to somebody's house or somewhere, then some person is going to die. You know, this was the belief of the people. And nor in the month of Safar, wala safara. Hamata is an owl, and they had a belief that when you hear the sound of the voice of the owl, somebody would definitely going to die at the home. Some person or some animal is going to die. Wala safara, and nor in the month of Safar. And they have a belief that Safar is a disease, and it is a contagious disease. But Allah, Prophet says, nor in the month of Safar. There is no bad omen in the month of Safar or in the diseases, because they said that the Safar is the name of the disease and it is contagious. So this hadith says that, and there is no, evil omens in the month of Safar, and the diseases are not also contagious. The other hadith we see, that the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he who takes omens of he for whom omens are taken is not from us. Laysa minna tatayyara aw tutayyara lahu. So, this means that ta ya ra is the root word. Tayrun means what? Bird. Tayrun is bird. Okay. So, they used to take the bird, and if the bird goes right way or right side, then I'm not going to do this word. Something good is not going to happen. If it goes on the left side, good is going to happen. I should do this, that. You know, these were their superstitions. So there's nothing such. Okay. Now we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that the purpose of the different stages of the moon, it helps us to mark the beginning and end of the months. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also told us that there are 12 months. Okay. Then we see, verily, the number of months with Allah is 12. 12 months in a year. So was it ordained by Allah on the day when he created the heavens and the earth. So this is from Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 36. You know, these 12 months is not man-made. We haven't made the 12 months. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made these 12 months when he created the heavens and the earth. At that time, he made these 12 months. It is this revolution of the day and night that makes up weeks and months and years, everybody knows that, which constitutes time, regarding which Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, there's a hadith, the son of Adam hurts me for he abuses time, though I am time. Everybody say, oh, now this time is not good. Previous, you know, era was good. So Allah doesn't like this, that this time. Allah says, the son of Adam hurts me for he abuses the time, though I am time. And in Urdu, it is called Zamana. So I am time, in my hands are all things, and I cause the revolution of day and night. Day and night comes by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from here, from this hadith, it is very clear that day and night is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And considering any time, any hour, any day, any month, or any year to be unlucky, taking bad omens is great misconception, and it is a sin. It is a sin. So we shouldn't do that. So now we see the historical perspective. Okay, what is the history behind it? Now, the Arabs, you know, what they used to do? They used to hold 3 months of Zilqada, Zulhijja, and Muharram. Okay, 1 month before Zulhijja and 1 month after Zulhijja, meaning Zilqada, Zulhijja, and Muharram as sacred. They did not, and Rajab was also sacred for them. They, in these sacred months, they did not indulge in war or crime during these months. They used to wait for these months to be over because these were the sacred months. So they were, you know, habitual of looting and, you know, the caravans coming and the people going to the business trips. They used to, you know, loot the caravan and, you know, steal the things. So they used to wait for these months to be over so that they can be free from these restrictions and indulge in robbery. Why they were restrictions? They were not doing theft and war and these things, because these were the sacred months, the Zilqada, Zulhijja, and Muharram. Therefore, as soon as Muharram used to be over and Safar began, they would leave their houses vacant with the intent of crime, theft, robbery, and war. Zilqada passed, Muharram passed, what they used to, Zulhijja passed, they would leave their houses and they would start theft, robbery, and war. Thus, there is an idiom. What is the idiom? Safar al-makan, meaning empty houses. Safar or sifar, we say zero, right? What we say zero. And in Arabic, zero is called safar or sifar. So sifar or safar means what? Nothing. Zero means nothing you have in hand. So thus the idiom safar al-makan. Makan is your house, okay? Safar al-makan, meaning empty houses, became famous. The word safrun or sifrun, safar or sifrun, safar or sifar means to become vacant. Like the saying goes in Arabic, sifrun minal mata, which means the house were vacated from its furniture, things, etc. Because they left the house, nobody was there to use the furniture. They left the house in after the 3 sacred months passed to, you know, do robbery and theft and everything. Now, Lisan al-Arab Az bin Manzur, volume P462-463, it is said about this month. They did the theft and all. The famous Hadith scholar and historian Sakhawi has written in his famous book, Al-Mashur fi Asma al-Ayyam wa Shahur, that this was the reason for naming of this month as Safar. When the Arabs saw that during this month many crimes were committed, people killed and houses emptied, they associated bad omens and ill fate with this month, instead of looking at their own evil deeds and wrongdoings. Actually, they were doing the theft and raging the war, so they didn't see that. They didn't, you know, instead of looking at their own evil deeds and wrongdoings, they said that the month of Safar has a bad luck, okay? Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that every person is responsible for his own omen and fate. And for every person, we have imposed his fate upon his neck and we will produce for him on the day of resurrection a record which he will encounter spread open. Everything will be there. A book of deeds will be open for us, and we will be accountable for that. It is Surah Bani Israel, and the other name of Surah Bani Israel is Al-Isra, ayah number 13 and 14. So it is commonly believed that bad omens come from external sources, which is why man tends to blame either some other person or animal or an object, a day or a month or a number, whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through this ayah has made it very clear that every man's omen and bad luck is due to his own misdeeds and wrongdoings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further says in the Quran, I will tell you the ayah, okay, I'll show you the ayah also. So, you know, telling some figure 13, like, you know, here we don't have 13 number in the elevators. Everybody knows that because they have got superstition that 13 number is not good. Or, you know, telling any day like Tera Tizu, that 13 day of Safar, they say it's a bad luck day. So we shouldn't say that, you know. This is, you know, this ayah says that that bad luck is due to his own misdeeds and wrongdoings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further says in the Quran, what comes to you of good is from Allah, okay? But what comes to you of evil, O man, is from whom? What comes to you of good is from Allah, but what comes to you of evil, O man, is from yourself, because you do, you know, misdeeds. And we have sent you, O Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to the people as a messenger, and sufficient is Allah as witness. Whatever we do, Allah is witness. Well, everything is written, you know, in our book of deeds. So the messenger disassociates himself from the one who takes an omen. This is the hadith. Imran bin Hussein saw a man wearing a band made of brass. He asked, what is this? He replied, it is due to weakness. He said, if you die while wearing it, you will be entrusted to it. The messenger of Allah SWT said, the one who takes ill omens, or the one for whom ill omens are taken, the one who practices fortune telling or has his fortune told, the one who did magic, or the one for whom magic is done, is not from us. He's not a Muslim. He's not from the Ummah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So going to the fortune teller and asking the future, in future what will happen with me, I will get the resurrection and I'll get the resurrection and provision or also not, to whom I'll be married, etc., or doing magic. You know, Prophet said that he is not from us. And you know that man on the top, the hadith I read, that he was wearing a band of brass. So what he was said, that if you die while wearing it, you will be entrusted to it. Because he was asked, what is this? He replied, it is due to weakness. So your weakness, or, you know, these things are not going to overcome your weaknesses or anything, you know. So this hadith, what it is said, that if you die while wearing it, because this is your belief that, you know, my weakness will go away, so you will be entrusted to it. You have no faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you whom you trust, the things, the resources, and you have worn this band, so it's not going to help you anyway. Okay, so we see that it is commonly believed that bad omens come from external sources, which is why man tends to blame either some other person or animal. And we saw this ayah also. What comes to you of good is from Allah, but what comes to you of evil, O man, is from yourself, from your own bad deeds you do. Now, superstitions to shirk. What is shirk? Shirk is associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. A man leaves his home. On the way, a black cat crosses his path. He thinks this is a bad omen and therefore returns back home. What will happen? I think this is a foolishness. You see a cat, black cat, and you come home. You are not going to study. You are not going to do, if you are going to for the dawah work, to spread the deen, you are not going to do that, right? you're not going to do anything, because if you, you know, you have got that superstition, you are not going to school, college, you won't be educated. Though this seems to be such a minor act, however, in reality, it really means that he thinks that the bad cat, that the black cat has the power and authority to change the man's fate. No, the black cat or any other things cannot change the, it doesn't have got the power and authority to change your fate. So this is shirk, because it means that the that other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the cat also has control and authority over a man's life and to bring harm to him. Nauzubillah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Now the other common superstitions, beliefs prevalent in our society are seeing someone disliked in the morning means the whole day will be full of bad luck. You know, I've always heard, oh my God, I saw her face early morning, I saw his face, he or she came to my house, and now my day will not be good. So this should, this is also no superstition. And some people, twitching eyes means bad luck. If the eyes twitch, their eyelids, they say, no, I will have a bad luck. And they say that it is an evil portent. Itching in the right palm means money will be acquired. Oh, my right palm is itching, so I'll get the money. And if my left palm is itching, the money will go away. These are all superstitions. If one shoe comes on top of the other, it means a journey will be undertaken. And you know, in my time, when I was a child, it was told in our family, oh, you know, the one shoe is on the other shoe, there will be a fight in the house, in the family, keep the, you know, shoe picket, don't keep it up, one on the other, keep it down. Taking omens from colors, such as wearing black means illness will strike, or not wearing black clothes, because black is the color of the cover of the Kaaba. And the other, you know, superstitions is not wearing green color shoes due to respect, because green is the color of the dome of the Prophet and mosque, Masjid-e-Nabawi, okay? Holding such beliefs, what happens that such, okay. Now when somebody sees the black cat, right? And, you know, he says that, oh, now something bad will happen. I should go back home. So it is a said that taking omens deprives one of high ranks. The one who practices, the messenger of Allah said, the one who practices fortune telling or has his fortune told, and one who returned from a journey, like seeing something black cat, or, you know, I saw this man. Now I saw her, I saw him, and he's not a, you know, good man, good, so my day will be bad. And once returned from a journey, and because he has taken the omens, so will be deprived of high ranks in Jannah. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. We are losing high ranks in Jannah. And if we, and even seeing the, you know, horoscope, before that we used to see into the newspapers and into the magazines, but now it's a click-click thing. It's a click-click thing. You just click your mobile, you download some app or, you know, some website you go, which is, you know, telling your horoscope. Oh, you are born in, you know, I don't know which month. So you have got, your star is Aquarius, your star is Scorpion, and you are this and that. You are then all the stars' names also. According to the month you are born. So this is going to happen. This week is good for you. This week is bad for you. So it shouldn't be done. This is also fortune, it comes into the fortune telling. And your worship of 40 nights is not accepted if you go to the fortune teller or you see the horoscope. We should believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not in all these things, horoscope, daily morning, you know, seeing the horoscope. And believe me, every week, you know, they have got the same thing. Aquarius, this will happen to you. Scorpion, you was born in such and such date, you are Scorpion, this will happen to you. Same repetition is there. And you know what we are earning? We are deprived of high ranks in Jannah. Okay? It is said, okay. Now, holding such beliefs not only led man to make halal things haram on himself, but led him to associate fate and destiny with these things. So our fate and destiny Allah has made, not these things, which is not only a great misguidance, but a great sin and shirk. Because no one other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power and control over man's fate. and all the things from which good or bad portents are derived are nothing but creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The black cat, or you know, we go to the fortune teller. Allah have created them. How can they be the, they have the authority and control of, upon our fate or destiny. They cannot change, or they cannot do anything. And all the things from which good or bad portents are derived are nothing but creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have no control over other creation. Prophet Sassam said, taking omens is shirk. Taking omens is shirk. He said it 3 times. See the hadith on the screen. He said it how many times? 3 times. Taking omens is shirk. Taking omens is shirk. He said it 3 times. Every one of us has some superstitions, but Allah removes it by trust in Him. This is the riwayah, the hadith from Sunan Abi Dawud. Whoever lets evil omens stop him from doing something is guilty of shirk. Okay. He also said a person who derived bad luck from something and refrained from doing what he was intending to do, he has committed shirk. The companion asked him what would be its expiation. The Prophet ﷺ replied, he should make this dua: Allahumma la khayra illa khayruka, wala tayra illa tayruka, wala ilaha ghayruk. He should say, O Allah, there is no goodness except the goodness that comes through you, and there is no omen except an omen that comes through you, and there is no true deity except you. Masnad Ahmad. You can take the screenshot of this dua, and please say this dua. I always try to say this dua because where as a child I've always seen in India, Pakistan, all these things, taking, you know, superstitions, all the superstitions I told you. And when this session ends, I'll take your reflections also. What superstitions you know, the bad omens, the bad luck, the superstitions and the misconceptions. Okay, so make this dua: Allahumma la khayra illa khayruka, wala tayra illa tayruka, wala ila ghayru. Okay. So this is the dua. Please take the screenshot and keep on, you know, making this. Okay. The cure to taking ill omens is strengthening iman, faith. Ubadah bin Samit advised his son, Allahumma la khayra illa khayruka, wala tayra illa tayruka, wala ilaha ghayruk. I told in the previous image, we did the translation also. The calamity that reached you was not to miss you, and the one that missed you was not to reach you. So there shouldn't be a blame game that, oh, alas, I would have done this, then it wouldn't have happened. I should have said this. She told me to do this and I did this, so there shouldn't, so, you know, the calamity has fallen on me, the hardships and come on me, so there shouldn't be a blame game, right? There shouldn't be a blame game. So being Muslim, we should have full faith and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believe from our heart that it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has power over us. The Arabs used to hold 3 months of Zilqada, Zulhijjah and Muharram as sacred. They did not indulge in war or crime during these months. They used to wait for these months to be over so that they can be free from these restrictions and indulge in robbery, theft and war. Therefore, as soon as Muharram used to be over and Safar began, like we are in the month of Safar nowadays, they would leave. This is the second month of Islamic calendar. They would leave their houses, and first month of Islamic calendar is Muharram. Second is Safar. They would leave their houses vacant with the intent of crime, theft, robbery, and war. Thus, the idiom Safar al-Makan, meaning empty houses, become famous. We did that. Okay. The famous hadith. And for every person, we have imposed his fate upon his neck, and we will produce for him on the day of resurrection a record which he will encounter spread open. Okay. Okay. The idiom is on the screen. Thus, the idiom Safar al-Makan, meaning empty houses, became famous. The word Safun or Sifun means to become vacant, like saying goes in Arabic. Sifun means mata, which means the house was vacated from its furniture, things. The famous Hadith scholar and historian Sakhawi has written in his famous book Al-Mashur fi Asma'il Ayyam wal Shuhur that this was the reason for naming of this month as Safar. When the Arabs saw that during this month many crimes were committed, people killed and houses emptied, they associated bad omens and ill fate with this month instead of looking at their own evil deeds and wrongdoings. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that every person is responsible for his own omen and fate. And for every person we have imposed his fate upon his neck, and we will produce for him on the day of resurrection a record which will be encounter spread open. It will be said, read your record, sufficient is yourself against you this day as accountant. Okay. Then we see another this thing, what comes to you of good is from Allah, but what comes to you of evil, O Muhammad, is from yourself. And we have sent you, O Muhammad, to the people as a messenger, and sufficient is Allah, witness. Allah is witness. Allah knows what we do, right? Okay. Visiting an astrologer. What will happen if you visit an astrologer? The messenger said, the one who went to a soothsayer or an astrologer and ask him about anything, his prayers will not be accepted for 40 nights. So we shouldn't go to them. Nobody is Alimul Ghaib. Nobody knows what will happen tomorrow except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They just take the money and, you know, they just befool the people. And this is their business. This is their job to earn money. And, you know, we shouldn't go. And what will happen? His prayers will not be accepted for 40 nights. And then, you know, there's a other this thing, hadith, curing ill omens through dua. How we can cure? It is masnoon to read the following after every obligatory salah. Allahumma la mania lima ataita, wala mutia lima manata, wala yanfau zaljaddi min kaljad. Oh Allah, no one can prevent what you have willed to bestow, and no one can bestow what you have willed to prevent, and no wealth or majesty can benefit anyone as from you is all wealth and majesty. So whatever is going to befall you, calamity, no one can prevent, hardships, anything, no one can prevent you what you have willed to bestow, and no one can bestow what you have willed to prevent, and no wealth or majesty can benefit anyone as from you is all wealth and majesty. So always after you finish your obligatory prayer, make this dua. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that one more thing we'll do, and entering Jannah without accountability. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, 70,000 people of my followers will enter paradise without account, without reckoning, because the book of deeds will be open on the day of resurrection. And you know, we will see every person will see the book of deeds, whether good, bad, whatever is done. But 70,000 people of my followers will enter paradise without account. And who are they? And they are those who do not practice incantation and do not take evil omen in things, no superstitions, no evil omen, no misconception, and put their trust in their Lord. They don't go to the, you know, soothsayer or fortune teller. They always trust in their Lord, because nobody can, you know, tell you your future, and nobody knows the unseen. Only Allah knows the unseen. And now what happens? We see on WhatsApp what people do. They pass the messages. They recite 10 times Ayatul Kursi and 100 times Surat Al-Fatiha and Darood Sharif, and pass it to 100 people, 100% to your 100 contacts, and you will get the reward. And if you don't do that, it is a sin and something bad will happen to you. So don't be scared of them. Don't be scared of them. There is nothing, you know, such like that. That you pass such and such, you know, you recite such and such time. This is your own will. You recite for to please Allah, for the sake of Allah. Not, you know, being scared of the people they send you on the social media that pass these things to 40 people and 50 people, some Darood Sharif and some verse of the Quran and this and that. please don't get scared of these things. In fact, you pray for yourself, you know, to please Allah. And, you know, we shouldn't be, you know, scared of these. And before this social media, people used to, you know, phone each other or send the letters, and they used to say they write so many times and, you know, pass it on to so many doors, so many neighbors, and keep it at their door and you will get the reward. And if you don't do that, you will be punished. It is a sin and this and that. So these are, you know, all superstitions. Don't believe in that. You must be getting on, you know, WhatsApp, all these messages. Okay. And then we see that one other thing is has started nowadays. What people do that they believe in evil eye, and what they do, that is one eye. You must have seen. They wear that picture. They make the, you know, necklace and wear in their neck. And sometimes they, that evil eye, they hang in their houses. You know, they hang in their houses like this. See, evil eye. And they say that if we hang it or if we wear it as a bracelet or as a ring or as a necklace, then what will happen? We'll be safe from evil eye. If this one eye we keep, we wear it, we hang it, then what will be happen? We will be safe from evil eye. And if somebody sees us with evil eye, it won't fall us or fall on us. And it resembles the eye of the Dajjal. You know, they compare it with the Dajjal also. And, you know, we get, see the evil eye on the clothes have also. So please don't wear these clothes. Don't wear this evil eye ring, bracelet, or necklace, or, you know, hang something like, you know, on your wall at home, or as a keychain, put your keys in the, please don't do that. Because this is the belief that this will save us from evil eye. There are many, many duas which can save us from evil eye. In the end, I'll show you all the duas. And you have got Vayakanastain also, the book. In that, you have the in Urdu meaning, the Urdu translation, the English translation, you have that Vayakanastain of evil eye and, you know, of cure and everything, right? So this is associating, this is shirk. Because if we believe in this evil eye, this one eye, and we wear bracelet and, you know, necklace and hang it as a keychain, or we wear these sort of dresses. So please be aware when you buy some dresses also, because they believe that this, if we do this, hang it or wear it, what will happen? We will be safe from the evil eye, and it resembles the Dajjal also. So we will be safe from this. So this is associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is doing shirk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I will forgive the sins of my my servant, no matter they are equal to the heavens and the earth. If he meets me with the sins equal to the heaven and earth, but if he or she has done tawbah, istighfar, he or she has repented, I will forgive them. I will forgive my servant. But if somebody comes with shirk, has associated partners with me, then I am not going to forgive them. I'm not going to forgive them. So, and you know, there's another misconception that they keep knife near the newborn baby. They keep the knife and they say that this knife will save this newborn baby from the evil eye. So please be aware of this. Don't follow this. Don't hang on your, you know, houses or on your door or anywhere. Don't wear this evil eye. And you know, this is a shirk. And be aware of these clothes also, because this is their belief that we will be safe from evil eye if we, you know, wear or hang these things. So please avoid. And the other dua, when you go to sleep, after each prayer, this is the riwayah. This is this Mughaira bin Shuaib wrote to Muawiyah when the Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam finished the prayer and pronounced salutation, he uttered these supplications. What is the supplication? La ilaha illallah. After your each obligatory prayers, first say the fourth kalma. Actually, fourth kalma is the dua, but we prefer from Asia, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, we say fourth kalma. chautha kalma. So this is the fourth kalma, this is the dua, but scholar says it is a dua. La ilaha illallahu wahdahu la sharika lahu lahul mulk wa lahul hamd wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allahumma la mani'a lima ataita wa la mutiya lima manat wa la yanfa'u zal jadd minkal jadd. And then you say other dua. First it is fourth kalma, then you say wa huwa, fourth kalma finishes at wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, then say allahumma la mani'a lima ataita. So the see the translation on the right, on the left side in green. There is no God but Allah. He is alone, who has no partner. To him belongs the sovereignty, and to him praise is due, and he is potent over everything. He, O Allah, no one can withhold what you give us or give and what or give what you withhold us. And the riches cannot avail a wealthy person with them. Okay, and before I showed you, that was only the Allahumma la mani'a lima atayta, but you should add this fourth kalma with this. We'll see that dua again. Allahumma la mani'a lima atayta wala mutiya lima manata wala yanfu zal jaddi minkar jaddu. O Allah, no one can prevent what you have willed to bestow, and no one can bestow what you have willed to prevent, and no wealth or majesty can benefit anyone, as from you is all wealth and majesty. No wealthy person can benefit us, because Allah alone can, he is all wealthy, and his majesty can prevent us from and all the calamities, hardships. No rich person, nobody's wealth can prevent us. And whatever is going to befall us is going to befall us. Nobody can prevent that. Only Allah can, you know, prevent us from those calamities and hardships and everything. So please avoid all these things. And everybody knows this dua. And there are other duas. A'udhu bi kalimatillahi tammati min kulli shaitani wa hamma wa min kulli ani lama. You have got the English translation of these duas of evil eye. And to save oneself from diseases and from hardships and calamities. In open Vayakanastain, you have got English, the translation in English also. And this is the dua again. There are two pages of dua, okay? So we have got everything. All the solutions are in the Quranic and Masnoon duas. Quranic duas are from Quran, and Masnoon duas are from the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which Professor Sam has taught us. So we don't need going to the, you know, fortune tellers, or, you know, seeing the horoscope, or if, you know, evil eye has fallen on you also, then there are so many duas. Alhamdulillah, we have got the treasures of dua, and you can find the English translation there, okay? So now I will take reflections from everybody, inshallah. Waakhiru da'wana anilhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Barakallah fi ilmik wa amalak wa rizqukum wa aqatukum wa ahlukum wa malukum. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. May Allah increase you all in your, and me also, in your knowledge, in your good deeds, in your risk, provision, sustenance, in your time, in your family, in your property. May Allah accept your coming, sitting, and we should refrain from, may Allah make us from those will get the highest level of Jannatul Firdausul Ala, and may Allah refrain us from all these omen and superstitions. May Allah save us from all these. So and when you make this dua after each prayer, right, after each obligatory prayer, what happened? You will be safe from all these superstitions, inshallah, because dua has the power, right? Dua has the power. Jazakallah khairan kathiran kathira. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now I would love to take your reflections. And you know, I want to know, everybody, if we keep the dars on Sunday, are you all ready to, you know, come on Sunday on Zoom? The time will be same, 3:00. How many can come on Sundays instead of Saturday? How many are ready to come?
Inshallah, we'll see. You know, Saturday, Sunday, both days are holiday. You know, like, you know, there is no school, so sometimes we go outside. But either way, inshallah, you know, anything could happen, like Saturday or Sunday. So to me, like,
inshallah, we'll confirm on the group that how many are available. If maximum are available on Saturdays, sometimes Saturdays. If maximum are available, including me, on Sundays, then we'll do on Sunday, okay?
So inshallah. You want to do instead of Saturday, Sunday, right?
We'll see the, you know, what Raisa and Fatma, we'll see on the group.
Okay,
that,
no problem.
How many can come on Sundays and how many come on Saturdays, okay? We try to.
Okay,
I'll see my position also. So we have got the option, okay?
I think I'm okay, you know.
Right? Okay. How about Hiba? Hiba is also, I think, okay, yeah. Okay. One by one, give me the reflections, what you learned today, and tell me the superstitions which are prevailing in this society. Okay, come on, tell me.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.